I grew up in Palo Alto. I was the paper boy at the house where Steve Jobs used to live and where Larry Page lives today. I like to say there was a neighborhood. And I went away for a decade, and I came back in 1977. There was this thing called Silicon Valley. Don Hoffler had named it. The world had changed. And so, for me, this book was an effort to sort of figure out what happened while I was gone. And you know, just a note before I start about psychedelics. I went to college in the 1960s. And the only thing I want to say about LSD is that, like Bill Clinton, I didn't inhale. And also a note about my employer, which has a very stringent drug policy. And there was this evening in 1988 where I was entirely paranoid about the poppy seed bagels that I'd had. And I thought I was never going to work again. So, but the 1960s were this era of, I mean, I use the word augmentation, but, you know, other people talk about mind expansion, and it was a period of exploration, and I don't think there's a good explanation of why it was different than it is now. I think it was a very different time. It was a time where I was growing up, and I have some theories, though, about sort of what was different that I'd sort of like to share. I mean, when I got into Doormouse, I was sort of, how many of you know who Carrie Mullis is? He wrote a book called Dancing in the Minefield, a really wonderful book. And I started looking for that kind of connection, because Carrie Mullis, who is a biochemist who invented polymerase chain reaction, PCR, he very clearly talks about this experience he had when he was driving up to his cabin in Mendocino in what he described as an acid puke state, and he figured out PCR, this technique for amplifying DNA, which was the foundation for modern biotechnology. It just changed the world in so many ways, and it was such a clear connection. And so I spent a lot of time looking for that kind of connection in the information technology world that I was writing about, and I have to be honest, I didn't find it. I found a lot of people who got high a lot, and the closest I got, actually, is probably to this audience, this is a story that means something. In talking to a member of the small talk team, whose name is Dan Ingalls, Dan was the person who invented BitBlit transfer, and you know, BitBlit was kind of the foundation technology for modern GUIs. And I was sort of wondering, well, you know, is there this kind of connection? And Dan would certainly acknowledge that he smoked a fair amount of dope. He would often smoke dope to get in the mood to program, but there wasn't that kind of direct, kind of a flash of insight connection. And Doug Engelbart's another great example, because Doug was a member of a group of people who went through this very intense experience with LSD. The problem is he invented an obstacle before he took acid. When he did take this very intense experience, he came up with this device that he called the tinkle toy, which is a device you put in the toilet and then boys pee on it. So it was fun. It was so I have what I think, I'm sort of a failed social scientist, and my sort of the mechanism that was at work there comes from some social scientists around the Santa Fe Institute who talked about creativity happening on the edge of chaos. And that certainly described the social milieu that I was reporting on. And I think there's a lot to that, although I'm approaching it as a journalist, not as a social scientist, and it's just my personal theory. But you know, the thing that set that time apart from today is that there was this intersection of these three forces around this very small part of the world. There was this counterculture that grew out of drugs and music, and sort of this back to the land impulse. There was this anti-war movement that was a very strong force in society. I can't tell you, in doing interviews at SRI and at Park, Gerard's Park, how many young men decided to go to work in these laboratories to avoid the draft. And if the draft hadn't been around, they might have done something else in the world. And so, you know, what kind of a forcing function was that? I think it was a real serious factor. You know, and then also the thing about the augmentation, I'm kind of find myself to be an anti-Kurzweilian, if you will. He sees exponentials, I see S-curves. And I think that if, I mean, I come at this as sort of a social determinist, if you will. I'm not a technological determinist. I think the technologies have emerged from the politics and the economics and the culture of our time. And that's sort of what I tried to define in Doormouse. And so, so I put a stake in the ground at a bookstore called Kepler's. And this was browsing before the web. You go into this little building here and you walk around and see books. And it was really a cultural center during the 1950s and the 1960s. It was an off-campus Stanford bookstore. It was a paperback bookstore. The Grateful Dead played there before they were the Grateful Dead. Ira Sandpro would chase them out at the end of the evenings. But it was really a touchstone of the community. And I put a stake in the ground there. And if you know, during the second half of the 1960s, if you drew a circle around Kepler's about a mile and a half, you run into this amazing sort of set of countercultural institutions. There was, of course, which I'll talk about, the International Foundation for Advanced Study, which was one of the vectors of LSD coming into the community, this technical community, before the acid tests. Not largely described, but 350 largely technical people were given this really remarkable LSD experience for $500 a piece. I'll talk a little bit about that. There was the Portola Institute. It was the institute that funded the Whole Earth Catalog. And the Whole Earth Catalog, again, was the web before the web. We used it like the web. And it was started by this man by the name of Stuart Grant. And Stuart had started out, and I'll talk about it a little bit more, but so there was the Whole Earth Catalog store, there was the Whole Earth Catalog truck store. When Stuart started, he originally had this notion that he was going to be the Sears catalog for hippies who'd gone back to the land. And that didn't work out so well, so he just started the catalog. And the catalog had this huge impact on the world. There was the Free U, which was MOOCs before MOOCs, right? It went from zero to almost 50,000 people in the Bay Area taking these classes that they sort of self-generated out of the counterculture in the space of just a year or two, and then went back to zero just as quickly. It was just this blip on the horizon. And there was Briarpatch, this cooperative market that was, there was the co-op, which was sort of 1940s, 1950s cooperatives, and then there was this other cooperative that was a pharmacy and a food co-op and an auto co-op. And all of these things were bubbling. And in the middle of that, there were these three laboratories. There was Doug Engelbart's Augmentation Research Center, there was the Stanford AI Lab, and then later, in 1970, there was Xerox PARC. And one of the things that struck me, and this is sort of what I'm obsessed with today, actually, still, is that there was two labs in the mid-1960s that started. On one side was Doug Engelbart, who was entirely outside the context of the computing world of that time. He was an outlier. And his idea was basically to augment human intelligence by using computer technology to bootstrap small groups of people. On the other side of campus, there was a lab started by John McCarthy, a really interesting character. And his idea, starting in 1964, was to build an artificial intelligence to replace the human mind. At that point, he thought it was a 10-year problem. How'd that work out? But that tension, I'm just fascinated by that tension that I see almost everywhere between extending the human mind, extending the human capabilities, and replacing them. And it's really striking to me that just in the past year, the automation debate has come back with a vengeance in our society as the technology sort of spins up. I'm going to take you through a random walk to some of my characters in my book and tell some of their stories. To give you something of the flavor, and then we can talk more. This is Bill and Ann Duvall. And, these were two young people at that point who worked for Doug Engelbart's lab at SRI. There was a Watson come here quick moment of the ARPANET. Before there was the internet, there was the ARPANET. And there was a first communication. There was that very first. And Bill was on the Menlo Park side of that first communication between Menlo Park and UCLA. And what happened was, Bill had written the software for the Menlo Park side. And it basically, the ARPANET was created to be a network to provide remote access for the online system, which was Doug's software. NLS was the first killer app. And so what you did was you logged in remotely to NLS. And so, of course, it was L-O-G, and it crashed at G. And guess what? It was a buffer overflow. That has changed in the last 4 years. You wrote the software there and got things going. So basically, I got started on the book because I was at a billionaire's house many, many years later in the late 1990s. And they were having a dinner for Doug Engelbart, and people were telling stories. And what I realized is that none of the stories, were not about building the technology. They were the stories about what was going on in people's lives while they were building the technology. And nobody was capturing those stories. I mean, even, I can't tell you, when you spend time in archives like I do and read oral histories, they're so dry. But give people a couple of bottles of wine and put them together, and you get stories that you just otherwise missed. And after we talked, we realized that nobody was capturing these stories. And we first started to do it as a documentary film, and none of us were filmmakers, and it devolved into this book. So so Bill would later go to Xerox PARC and work on something that came before the Alto. And then later he wrote the first assembler and the first compiler for the Macintosh. He wrote the first C for the Macintosh. And then after he wrote the first web filter to protect people from porn, he retired. The funny story about that was the way they found porn in those days is they hired Stanford students during the summer to look for it. Guess what? The girls were highly efficient and they could go through a lot of websites quickly. Doug Engelbart is my Moses. Probably most of you know the story, but he started with this idea of augmenting human intelligence, and he sort of made it his life story. And I won't really say a lot about this, but I think one thing that's worth noting about Doug is that when the first integrated circuits were built in the late 1950s, he immediately understood scaling. And the reason he understood scaling is he worked at NASA Ames, and he worked for the aeronautical engineers. And the aeronautical engineers, they started with small models and they scaled up. And so since he saw an integrated circuit, he realized what was going on. He wrote a paper called, Microelectronics and the Art of Similitude, which was this notion of scaling the aeronautical engineers. This was in 1961 in Philadelphia at the IRE, which was the predecessor to the ISSCC. He gave this talk about scaling and how much computing power was going to be available. And years later, I was interviewing Gordon Moore, and Gordon was in the audience and heard Doug give that talk, which I thought was really quite striking. We're getting toward that kind of computing power. So this is the first mouse. And what's cool about it is a couple things. First of all, why is the mouse this size? The first mouse had three buttons. Because three of the switches would fit in that case. They would fit in the size of the hand. Doug wanted 10 switches. Doug was a deep believer in complexity. His idea was you build complex systems and you master them, and that would give you sort of more powerful skills as a small work group. And it led to this war. One of the people who rejected that idea. So he was once talking to the Augment group, and they were building the online system, and it had, I don't know how many commands, verbs. And he asked, so how many should it have? People had various ideas. He thought it would ultimately have more commands or verbs than the English language. So one of the people who rejected that was a young man, Stanford student, who worked at Sales and was very Tesla. And I'll talk about him later. So I tried to find out why they named it the mouse. And actually, that's a really difficult problem. I don't think anybody really nailed it. But what I do know is that the first cursor was called a cat. And I believe it was called the mouse because the mouse and the cat chased each other around the screen. I think that's as close as I can get to the actual idea. In this culture, the other guy who was wandering around was this wonderfully crazy man by the name of Ted Nelson. And I thought of him as being tremendously quixotic. He was associated with a trained sociologist and studied under Talbot Parsons at Harvard. And he came up with the idea of hypertext at the same time on the East Coast at Brown and Harvard while Doug was doing it on the West Coast. He spent a lot of time on the West Coast. He was out and passed through. And what he did that had an impact on him,
Ted is famous for not finishing projects. Xanadu's, you know, his tour de force is still not finished, and he curses the web for basically perverting his idea of hypertext, which was the world was not the world did not act on until CERN, and he believes that he invented the backbone. But what he did do that had a real impact on the world is he wrote this book in 1974. On one side of his computer read and he turned it over, it was green machines. And basically the slogan was, you can and must understand computers. Now, it was written in opposition to IBM. He was really part of this sort of social force that was sweeping the country. People wanted to get their hands on computers and they couldn't get them. Yeah, they couldn't get their hands on them. And the book was read by an entire generation and had this, this huge impact. Ted's an amazing guy. About a decade ago, he showed me this, maybe even more, he showed me this database called Zigzag that he was working on. And it was the absolute worst user interface I could possibly imagine. Absolutely ununderstandable. And about 3 or 4 years later, I realized that he was showing me the semantic web. So he has this way of sort of coming up with really profound ideas. Another one of my characters was this young kid by the name of Fred Moore. And this is in sort of this is about serendipity. Fred Moore grew up in the shadow of the Pentagon. His dad worked for the predecessor of DARPA. As a high school student in 1957 or 58, in that environment, he decided he was a pacifist. And not clear how that happened, but he really took these pacifism to heart and decided that what he had to do is he had to go put his body in the way, and it happened to be this war on at this time in Cuba. You know, Castro was trying to take power, and so he basically ran away from home after his senior year of high school, and he took a bus to Florida. He got some food together. He planned to go to basically talk sense to combatants. He ran the motorboat and he took off for Cuba, which was 90 miles away from the U.S. And about 5 miles off of the shore, something sheared off the propeller on his boat. And he ended up floating for a couple of days. And finally, he was picked up. And he was so embarrassed by this failure, he didn't tell anybody about it. The next fall, he ended up at Berkeley. This was Berkeley in 1961. And he basically sat down on the steps of Spiral Plaza. This is still basically in the 50s. And staging a one-man protest against ROTC, which was mandatory at that point. And so the dean called his dad, and his dad flew out to take him home. He was taken out of school. But if you talk to people involved in the free speech movement, which was basically 3.5 years later, that act was noticed by people, and it was sort of the first act of defiance of the 60s, I would argue. Wow. And Fred would later go to jail as a draft resister and make his way up and serve time, and then in the early 70s, he showed up in the Bay Area, and he became an electronic hobbyist, and he was hanging out around that sort of storefront for the People's Computer Company, and they would have these great potlucks, and people would get together and they would talk about making their own computers because, you know, all the real computers were behind glass walls. And for some reason, the potlucks were about to end, and Fred became the co-founder of the Homebrew Computer Club. And he lasted about 4 or 5 meetings. He started the newsletter, and, you know, the Homebrew Computer Club was that spark that lit the fire that created the personal computer industry. And it basically took off and left him behind. He wanted to hold bake sales to fund the Homebrew Computer Club. And people were going in a very different direction very quickly. And he went off and returned to his life as a political activist and for many, many years. And then he died, I think probably 15 or 20 years ago in a car accident. There wasn't even an obituary. Is a man by the name of Myron Stolaroff. And on the right is Albert Hoffman, the man who invented LSD. Stolaroff was a fascinating character and one of the people I sort of pursued of that era. And it was in the Sequoia seminar that he ran into this man whose name is Al Hubbard, was Al Hubbard. Al Hubbard is one of the most interesting folk characters in American history. Al Hubbard first came on the scene in 1919 because in Seattle as a kid he built a perpetual motion machine. And then during the Second World War he was involved in all kinds of shady operations. He was apparently exporting weapons through Canada to Europe and importing uranium to the Manhattan Project into the United States.
And while he was going to Europe, he stumbled across LSD. And you know, most people sort of think about LSD sort of entering the culture in the 60s through Timothy Leary and Ken Kesey and the acid test. But before Ken Kesey, there was Al Hubbard. Al Hubbard was basically, and he was a devout Catholic who discovered LSD. And he was traveling up and down the West Coast, basically like Johnny Appleseed, turning people on. he turned on Elvis Huxley LSD in Los Angeles. There was sort of a group of people there. He stumbled into the Sequoia Seminar. And a group of people around Myron Stoloff branched out, basically six couples around technology companies in the late 50s in the Bay Area. HP, Variant, Ampex, SRI, Stanford, Hewlett Packard. And they were all experimenting with LSD. Remember, it was still legal. Stoloff, this was a life-changing moment for him. He was convinced that LSD would enhance creativity of engineers. He believed this passionately and tried to persuade the board of Ampex of this. Well, the board of Ampex didn't buy this. But with Hubbard, he took eight Ampex engineers into the mountains of the Sierra Nevadas, Nevada, and they basically took a lot of LSD one weekend. And one of them, a man by the name of Bob Sackman, had a really bad trip. He said it scared the hell out of him. Bob Sackman wasn't permanently damaged. Bob Sackman became a founding partner of U.S. Venture Partners. He was the founding investor in Sun Microsystems. So he survived this event. Stoloff's career at Ampex didn't. And so he left Ampex and he went off with another Stanford engineering professor, former Stanford engineering professor, a man by the name of Willis Harmon. And they started something a couple of blocks away from Kepler's called the International Foundation for Advanced Study. And for about 4 years, from 61 to 65 or 66, until LSD became illegal, they began experimenting with creativity and LSD. And I would argue that that was really the important vector of LSD coming into this largely technical culture, engineering culture, before the acid tests, which is sort of what we know about the popular sort of adaptation of LSD, adoption of LSD as a recreational drug for many people. Lots of people at SRI, lots of people at Hewlett Packard, technical people, engineers, architects, were all taken through this really extraordinary experience. Let me just read you what it was. One of the first people to go through this was a young man by the name of Stuart Graham. And this is what it was like. Let's see. Graham was one of the first to explore what billions would pursue during the next decade. It was a wrenching experience that pulled him out of his middle-class upbringing and gave him a new way of looking at the world. In a report that he wrote several days afterwards, he noted that he took a goblet containing the drug at 8:41 a.m. He then lay in a quiet room listening to classical music through headphones. He was then given a second goblet of LSD at 10 a.m. and a final dose by injection at 2 but Stuart was a remarkable person because he not only was what I consider to be the messenger in terms of bringing the idea of computing technology, he was so many things over such a long period of time. He was a married prankster. If you read Tom Wolfe's book, Electric Kool-Aid Acid Test, Stuart shows up in the first couple of pages. Steve Jobs, in his famous Stanford commencement speech, gave a shout-out to Stuart again because the whole catalog was so influential. And that sort of philosophy of stay hungry, stay foolish was at the heart of the whole catalog. Stuart was the first person to use the term personal computing. And he got that insight from visiting Salem Park in the early 70s. And he wrote this wonderful article, you should go look at it, you can see it on the web, in Rolling Stone, called The Fanatic Life and Symbolic Death Among the Computer Box. And let me read you the lead. Ready or not, computers are coming to the people. That's good news, maybe the best since psychedelics. It's way off the track of, quote, computers, threat or menace, school of liberal criticism, but surprisingly in line with the romantic fantasies of the forefathers of the science, such as Norbert Wiener, Warren McCullough, J.C. Licklider, John von Neumann, and Vannevar Bush. So he needed to know a little bit more about Norbert Wiener's view of the technology, but aside from that, it was really quite a remarkable point.
he's, I would argue, the person who discovered cyberspace. It was Stuart walking through Wilbur Hall at Stanford in early 60, 61 or 62, and seeing these young men playing this video game called Space War, which was the first video game, and sort of deciding they were having this out-of-body experience, which is what we call cyberspace. And a lot of this came together in two cybernetic cultures. But he was there at creation. I don't know if many of you know this event called the Demo, which involved Doug Engelbart bringing his interactive technology to the thousands sort of leading computer scientists in the world here in San Francisco at Brooks Hall in 1968. But they brought Stuart in as a multimedia consultant because he had done, out of the acid test, he had done this slideshow called America Needs Indians. And at that point, multimedia, remember, was three projectors in the screen. But there he is. He's in Menlo Park. You know, they had a microwave relay up to San Francisco, and Doug was sitting on stage in front of this huge screen. And the technology for projection at that time was absolutely insane. The projector basically, I think it wrote on this plate of oil. It was an arc light, right? And they had a windshield wiper. But anyway, they were able to project something behind them. It's just extraordinary. You can see it. The demo's on the web. And it basically changed everybody's orientation to modern computing all at once. They realized that computing wasn't about decks of cards anymore after they saw that. And in fact, there's this wonderful book called Dealers of Lightning about Xerox PARC. But the term Dealers of Lightning really was about Doug, because a young engineer by the name of Chuck Thacker came to work at Xerox PARC, and he was showing the video, because that's what they did, because it was such an extraordinary thing. And he said, you know, Doug was sitting up there on stage and he was dealing lightning with both hands. And it was both hands because he had this notion of the cord keyset as one thing. He had a mouse and the other and a keyboard. And the cord key, needless to say, didn't catch on. Although a young man by the name of Bill Duvall could type 55 words a minute with the cord keyset. And, you know, sure, this was called the yoga workstation at the group. But it was just an absolute sociology experiment. It wasn't a technology experiment. He was playing with all of these remarkable sort of techniques. He sent all of his researchers to the S. They took a lot of LSD. They were experimenting with encounter groups. They were experimenting with psychedelics. They were experimenting with Mao's little old book. And needless to say, in the early 70s, Doug's group basically blew up. It exploded just at sort of the height of its influence. It was sort of pulled apart by the politics and the cultures of its time. But you know, that's what he was trying to sort of, he was searching for the tools we all use today and don't think anything about. He was creating. It was a search for intellectual productivity. You know, on the same side of the other side of campus, on Rascadero Road, there was this was the Stanford Artificial Intelligence Laboratory. And it was an extraordinary counterculture institution. That's the only way you can describe it. What's not largely known about John McCarthy is that he basically grew up in a communist family. He was still in the party the first time he came to Stanford as a math professor in the 1950s. He was still in the party when he went to Princeton. In Princeton, I guess this was the early, the late 50s, there were three members of the communist cell, because they're always, you know, there was McCarthy, there was a black woman who worked as a cleaning person, and there was the FBI agent, because there was always a but McCarthy was on his way to the right. You know, he coined the term AI, invented Lisp, time sharing, and came to build a working AI. But, you know, there were people living in the attic, there were encounter groups, and a sauna in the basement. It was a really quite extraordinary place. And, you know, it was technology that came both from Sale and Augment that came together at Park in the 70s that was borrowed by Steve to create the Mac, and by Dill, actually. You know, both of them sort of took things away and were proud of it. This was a young man by the name of Bill Pitts. He was a young math student at Stanford in the early 60s, and he was a prototypical hacker. And one thing that hackers do is they break into things.
good hackers and bad hackers do that. And one of the things he did in his first year as a math student is he broke into all the buildings at Stanford. He found the steam tunnels, he found all the buildings, he found that little nipple at the top of Hoover Tower, and he broke into everything. He thought he had a nail. And then one day he was driving out to Zotts, which is this beer garden behind Stanford, and he saw this sign that was in Stanford lettering, and he realized he missed one. So he made a note to come back at night and drive. He drove up to Sale at 11 o'clock at night to break into the building, and the parking lot was full and all the lights were on. He said, there's hackers here. So he found his way into this sort of temple of hackers. And with a young friend, so one of the things they were running was Space War. And this was sort of 71 or 72, I'm a little late on the dates now, but he with a friend and some investment from his friend's family put together a version of Space War that was coin-operated. It was the very first video game. It preceded, well, so Nolan Bushnell, before he did Pong, which was a great success, did another rip-off of Space War called Computer Space. And they called it Galaxy Game, and it was in Trester Union. Because you couldn't call it Space War because it was the height of the anti-war period. But the deal was they had two screens, and you played the game by putting a dime on the top of the monitor, and you got to play as long as you kept winning. And it was there for 7 or 8 years, and it was just an introduction for so many people into interactive computing when you could get access to interactive computers. That's John McCarthy. He was an interesting guy. He was totally within the mainframe paradigm, but he invited the homebrew club to come hold their third meeting at Sale, and so they came out, and he was totally dismissive of personal computers. Why would somebody want some new computer like that when he had a new computer? But he actually, afterwards, he took out an ad in, I think, the third or fourth homebrew computer club newsletter, for a home terminal of users group. He thought for about $75 a month, you could have access to a lot of computing power at home. And it was it was a very important conversation. Les Ernest was an interesting guy because McCarthy couldn't manage anything, so he brought Ernest to be his administrator. Ernest came from the CIA, and he moved to the left while McCarthy moved to the right. It was a remarkable counterculture thing that was going on. And one of the stories that Les told me, actually, I haven't been able to verify this, but he was early and he probably knows, what was the first internet commerce transaction? He asserts that it was a drug deal between MIT and Stanford.
Works for me.
So this is a young man by the name of Winfield Diffie. One of the inventors of public key cryptography, which of course is the basis for how can two people even share a secret. So where did public key come from? Well, McCarthy had been in France proposing this home terminal notion, and he came back. Witt was supposed to be working for McCarthy on program verification. He was kind of bored. And they were talking about what the world was going to be like when there was a home terminal in everybody's house. And he began thinking about what would take the place of a check. And it was that famous because he was one of the people who gave a demo to Steve Jobs at Xerox PARC. But he was also someone who, from the very beginning, another man who played a really crucial role in almost everything. You know how people sort of down on Al Gore for having time to invent the internet? But Bob Taylor, I think, is probably one of the most unsung heroes of almost all the technology we use today. He funded, as a NASA administrator in the early 60s, he funded Doug to invent the mouse. And then he later came to work for JCR Linklater at DARPA, and he funded the ARPANET. He understood the need for the ARPANET, and his first day on his job, when he walked into his office in the Pentagon, and there were three separate terminals going to three DARPA projects. And it was just so obvious that we needed a single internet, if you will, and that was the purpose of the ARPANET very, very early on. And then he funded the team at Xerox PARC to build the ALPA, which is not bad as a track record for a single guy.
So, you know, this technology was all developed in the 60s and the early 70s, and that literally began to leak out of the labs. There was this generation of mostly young men who were dying to get their hands on computing, and they couldn't get access to it. This is a young man by the name of John Dreyfus. And John Draper, I would argue, was absolutely instrumental in the creation of Apple Computer. And the set of events was, to your point about Kevin about being an early phone freak, John Draper or Captain Crunch was a legendary phone freak, and he became famous when Ron Rosenbaum wrote an article about him in Esquire magazine called "Secrets of the Little Blue Box." And Wozniak's mom saw the article, and she copied it and sent a copy to Woz. And Steve was hanging out, Woz was in school at Berkeley, and Steve was hanging out with them, and they two of them spent 2 weeks looking for Draper, because they knew he was in the Bay Area and didn't know where he was. And Draper heard that they were looking for him. And one night, they were sitting in Woz's dormitory, and Draper walks in, and as Jobs told me, he walks in and says, "It is I." And he, of course, taught them how to build a blue box, and they build a blue box, and that's how they capitalized Apple, and on, you know, it's one of those wonderful stories. John's had this sort of well-chronicled, actually there's a book about him now, it just came out, a chronicled and tragic life. He's been a millionaire, he's lived on the street, he wrote the first word processor for the IBM PC, and he's a very, very interesting and colorful guy who was around the homebrew club and Apple in those early days. This is a young man by the name of Steve Dompier, who sort of was instrumental. I mean, I'll sort of end on a mystery. In a couple of the books on the early personal computer, Dompier, who was a hobbyist and was one of the first people to buy amidst out there, he was a carpenter in Berkeley. He was this obsessed with the notion of personal computer. And he actually drove his pickup truck down to Albuquerque to get a copy of an early amidst Altair computer. And of course, the only software was this copy of BASIC that had been written by these two kids from Harvard, Bill Gates and Paul Allen. And the MIDS Altair team was on this marketing tour running around the country to show off their computer, and they stopped at Ricky's Lighthouse, sadly now gone in Palo Alto. And they were showing it off, and during that weekend, while they were there, somebody stole a copy of BASIC, which at that point came on paper tape. And two of the books that have been written accuse Dompier of being the guy who stole BASIC. He swears that he didn't do it. And I went to visit him in Montana, where he lives now, and he actually has a copy of the original paper tape signed by Bill Gates thanking him for helping him beta test. So he said, "It wasn't me, I didn't need a copy." But whatever happened, a copy did get to a friend of Wozniak's, who then was a sort of an engineering manager at a company, semiconductor company down the road. And he had access to a high-speed paper tape copying machine, and he made 70 copies. And it was taken to the next meeting of the homebrew club, and people literally stampeded the stage, because it was, everybody had a MIDS Altair, and you had to toggle stuff in, and so they were dying for software. And the deal was, if you got a copy, you had to make a copy and share it. And of course, it took about 6 months at that time, and Bill Gates was 20 years older than found out about it, and he wrote this famous letter accusing the hobbyists of being thieves, in which he said, "As the majority of hobbyists must be aware, most of you steal your software." That was that moment of tension between the open internet was sort of the roots of open source and the world that we have today. There was a free version of BASIC floating around written by Dennis Allison. That's Dr. Dobbs. I think Dr. Dobbs is still there. That's a contraction of Dennis and Bob. Bob Albrecht was the guy who started People's Computer Company, and Dennis was Dennis Allison, who wrote Tiny BASIC. But this was the BASIC that everybody wanted. That's where I'll stop. I just sort of one thing I wanted to say, because I had this story this week about the Obama administration setting off on this really what I think is exciting project to map the human brain. And I'll leave you with, everybody uses this analogy about computers and brains and all of that. There was a meeting in January 17th with some people sort of trying to figure out, if you're going to map the whole human brain, do we have enough computational power to do it? And so the numbers are wonderful, like you remember them. So they're talking about their goal at the end of this process is to be able to measure simultaneously a million neurons. And a million neurons will generate about 3 petabytes of data in a year. So 3 petabytes, okay, we can deal with that. The Large Hadron Collider generates about 10 petabytes a year. But then you do the math, if there are 85 to 100 billion neurons in the brain, I was going through this, it's like 2 trillion minutes of HDTV is what the brain generates in a year. And I thought, we're so far away from it. That's what I'll leave you with. Kevin, you want to? Closer than that. I mean, you know, I looked, and you know, Dan Ingles was as close as I could come in. But I mean, you know, I was looking at a very small set. I did about 120 interviews to get the population. I took, in the late 1960s, the people who were sort of technical, I should call it, 300 or 400. But I had a pretty good sample. You know, I think that for that period in the 60s, almost everybody, so I'd probably say more than 50% of the people I talked to had some sort of an experience, but actually being able to, and that's what I couldn't find, and that's why I think that there's some other more sociological explanation. I think we approach it as journalists, not as a scientist.
So to the technology point, I mean, this is going to actually be at the heart of the controversy surrounding what's called the Brain Activity Mapping Project. They really want to create a two-way interface to the brain. And you know, if you grew up like I did on Neal Stephenson and Bill Gibson, you know, that's jacking into the net. Those guys, I mean, I talked in the last week to a variety of neuroscientists who believe that's possible. That you could, how do we get past the keyboard for data entry? Well, those guys are not only trying to read from neurons, they're trying to write to them. And at the moment, it's absolute science fiction, but when they're talking about synthetic biology approaches to do things non-invasively in the brain in terms of measuring and writing to the human brain. And, you know, to me it sounds just like science fiction, except I'm talking to neuroscientists.
The cultural sweet spot of the Valley is about 30 years old, and I'm about 33 years older than that, so I feel like so much older in the way. I do have a theory, though, that I'll run by you. So, you know, I can't tell you, I mean, I started working as a reporter covering the Valley in 1976, and you know, there was a period when, you know, people talked about creating Silicon mountains, Silicon deserts, Silicon this, Silicon forest, Silicon that, and nobody's done it. So it's baffled me, because I keep expecting, there was a period, I guess, before the iPhone, where I was spending time in Europe, and it really looked like mobility was going to happen first in Europe, and that they were ahead of us, and the center of gravity was going to move there. I've always sort of thought that the evidence of the Valley is over is when the first platform emerges outside of the Valley, and I keep waiting for that to happen. And it hasn't, and so why hasn't it? And I have this theory that's a little bit different than a lot of other theories, and that is that the chemistry that's special to the Valley is that the synergy of the Wozniaks of the world and the Jobs of the world. It's not just enough to be entrepreneurial, it's not just enough to be a hacker culture, it's this weird collision of the two that happened here that created Silicon Valley. And all the people in the rest of the world just jump on the entrepreneurial side of things. And they don't have sort of native hacker cultures. That's my theory. I have no support for it. The question that keeps you awake at night is I guess you'd call it technological blowback. I mean, if Al-Qaeda is sort of a U.S. CIA operation run amok or run awry, what are drones? I mean, what happens when the playing field is leveled? Drone technology is accessible to all sides. It seems to me to be inevitable, and it's only a matter of time, and why hasn't anything happened so far? Paul Saffo is the guy who says, never mistake a clear view for a short distance. And I stumbled across that in the Valley so many times. I mean, there were so many things that were obvious, and yet, the mouse took 20 years to arrive. Why did the mouse take 20 years to become a standard consumer? But I think that was something about Ted's work. Well, it was just too soon. All the components didn't fit together. I think that's my sense of Steve Jobs' impact. That the things that aren't always mentioned about Jobs and what he did is he had a better sense of timing. When the technology was right to be a consumer thing than almost anybody, he did it over and over again. It wasn't just when to start new technologies, it was when to kill new technologies. He knew when to kill technologies with some regularity. And know, maybe that came from growing up in Mountain View.